Hello. We're about to start. We're about to do this. Hello. Hello and welcome. So I was on Twitch. No, I was on my Discord channel the other day, and people were asking questions about the documentary for the Untitled album that MTV put out in 2003. I didn't know about it. Thank you very much. Peace, love, Zoe,
Yeah,
for the
right? Hot
subscriptions.
damn.
I didn't know about it. So I'm gonna watch it today, and I'm gonna tell you what's right and what's wrong about it, and memories, and we're just gonna have a great time. So, without further ado, let's go to this guy, and let's start the show. The problem is, I don't know how to export desktop audio to the Twitch stream. So, I think there's like a little half second delay. It's gonna be how it is, and I'm sorry.
From Blink-182. Welcome to Launch. We're here recording our new album in this house.
That was the
We have a
house.
house that our family lived in, or still lives in.
This family wants their home back. That would suck if we have to pick up and leave here.
Little did we know.
The pilot album is recorded.
How's the audio? Audio levels okay? Audio is good. Okay.
That's some one take right there, people. What happened while we were recording it?
Well, I've never been a father before. I'm still a kid, meeting and playing for the troops that are in the armed forces. It was the most enlightening, humbling experience I've ever had.
It's a long story. It feels like this record is taking forever to record and write. A story about friendship.
I'm gonna miss you, Travis.
I wish somebody fun would show up. Wasn't fun.
What an ass. Already, we're 45 seconds into the show, and I've already proven myself just to be an ass. Sorry.
Creative process.
The birth of the Yed. Birth of the Yed. Right there. That was it.
We just hit on something big. About the way that people treat each other. When people stop being polite and start getting real,
Just to explain to you guys, there used to be this, well, there still is. There's a station called MTV, and they used to play a lot of music videos. And that would be how people found out about music. So, for those of you who only remember MTV from the reality shows, there used to be a lot of music involved in the MTV. That was the house.
We all had an idea of recording in a house a few years ago, but it never really worked out. I think everyone was scared to death. But this time, we just said that we're gonna do it, and we moved into a house that family lived in. And now we're surrounded by all their photos. We feel guilty every time we run around naked and do weird things to our bodies.
We finished the last tour, but we haven't really done much with Blink since then.
We had a lot of time off to go do stuff that was creative. Everyone was having babies. I was gonna go off and just do the transplants.
Transplants. Love it.
I think during that time, like, we were just writing songs, like, individually, me and Tom. Over the past couple of years, I've had a lot happen to me personally, and so I started writing these darker, heavier types of songs, and that's what Boxcar Racer was. Start over. Now we're back, you know, it's like our little group. It's like being reunited with a girlfriend.
That's
I
it.
This record to take what people think Blink-182 is.
That's the beginning of feeling this right there. Well, bad pause. That was the beginning of feeling this right there. That was the... How do I rewind? That was the first day of recording. That was the 2nd. 2nd of January. Got to the studio. Nobody else was there except for me and Dave Carlock, the engineer. And I was asking him to show me how Pro Tools worked. And so he said, grab your bass and just start playing a bass and I'll show you how it all works. And so I started noodling this thing and then he programmed a drum beat to it. And then still nobody was there. And so I got on the turntables that Travis had delivered and started just going through his samples and found that action thing was messing around, and that's how Feeling This started.
Enjoy that or rebuild it in something really different than it's ever been.
There it is.
Put this record on and go, wait a second, that's Blink 182.
Oh, rad.
We've never had the time to just sit around and be creative, and we're fortunate enough right now that we can take over this house and try different ideas and try different sounds, and we're demoing everything right now.
Oh, did you see that? Here, I'm going back. Sorry. I'm going to go back. I'm not good at this, but you're going to have to deal with it. If you look behind Travis, I'm playing the original Animal Crossing behind him.
We've never had the time to just sit around and be creative, and we're fortunate enough right now that we can take over this house and try different ideas and try different
stuff. Right there! We're demoing everything. Animal Crossing.
We're still in the demo process of writing, and it's really allowed us to expand the way in which we write songs.
Any record I do, I'm going to treat it like it's my first record. And even as our band, like I was like, let's just pretend this is our first record. That way we're not worried about anything. We're not limited. We're not like, people don't expect anything. We're just doing whatever we feel like at the time.
Sounds me flowing. I was speaking with my drums.
Look how sweaty he is. About handsome man.
Record, it's got to be the very first day you walk in and you sit down and you pick up your guitar at all. I have an idea for a song.
Oh, I remember that song.
Every time you pick it up.
I remember that song. That song didn't make the record. That's a lost untitled album song called Punk Kid. That's not Up All Night. You think that's Up All Night?
Whatever we feel like at the time.
Sounds me flowing.
I don't know if that's a...
The hardest thing.
That part right there is Up All Night.
It's gotta be the very first day you walk in and you sit down and
that's Up All Night.
I have an idea for a song.
Yeah.
The sounds so f***y every time you pick it up.
Yeah, that song is called Punk Kid. Not the one where we were sitting on the couch, but the one that we were playing all three together. How'd that song go? Sorry. Sorry. That song go. And the chorus it was actually I brought in this progression to the studio. I didn't know what it should be about, and Travis was like, we were talking about how when we were growing up, pardon me, all of our teachers told us that we were never going to amount to anything and that we were losers. And so the chorus went, how'd it go? Don't remember how you talked about me. Remember how you talked about me. You never did a thing but doubt me. Said I'd never amount to anything. Yeah, Punk Kid. Cool. Okay, back to it, sorry.
Really done that for like a good year or 2 years or something, and sit down, and what you're hearing in your head is different from what they might be hearing with their ears. So you have to somehow ask them to get inside your head.
Yep.
I'm here the whole whole time, like, I'm not going nowhere. I usually record my drums and I break out, but this time I'm hanging out through the whole recording process.
I've never felt more comfortable recording stuff ever as we are in this house.
so many days.
The most challenging part of recording is just to keep the energy up, because you're in a studio and people think that recording is like this big party where everyone just rocks out, there's microphones and all of a sudden there's an album, but it's really a lot of, you know, sitting in a chair, listening to playback, doing things over and over and over again until you get it right.
How's that?
Somebody says turn up the YouTube volume.
Silence! Silence don't mean a thing. Silence don't mean a thing.
You know what recording is like? Recording is like doing this for 4 months in a row.
One more time, motherfucker, in the wind.
So you're right. You're out of key.
Silence don't mean a thing.
Play it faster. Play it slower. This sounds ugly. It's a horrible melody. What the f*** am I singing? It sounds like the devil came in through my butt and came out my mouth.
Silence!
Yeah,
it gets
you the higher
problem. I'm not feeling any of the f*** that I'm doing. It's nowhere as good as, like, music. It sounds like f***ing dark.
Let's just go on a new song and come back to this.
So see, there it was. That was the Death of Punk Kid right there.
I feel like my spirit's being broken over the camel's hump today. I want to start recording the actual record and stop demoing. There are too
many. Look at those baby blues.
I laid anything down on the tape. I want to start laying something on the tape. I'm ready to start recording.
In about a week or so, our producer's gonna come on down to the studio.
Jerry Finn.
Recording these songs
for you.
for you and your mom to listen to.
Jerry's here, and our engineer's here, and we're getting ready to.
There's Jerry.
Jerry's kind of like a, it'd be like if you're putting something together when you're a child, and your dad or your mother sitting over you going, okay, do this, they're kind of like telling you the steps if you get lost.
And then you stop. And wait for the one, and then you start over on the band again.
Working with Jerry is like having the fourth member of Blink-182.
Jerry!
Mr. Flint,
please come here.
He's a great producer in that he comes from a really strong musical background. He grew up playing in punk rock bands, and so he understands music, and he understands how a song should be structured.
I record that.
Okay, so what I was just doing, another day I got to the studio super early, and I was trying to learn Pro Tools, and I had all this gear. We had all the gear, obviously. And so I was making a joke song for the transplants to use to whack out on stage. And so it's like this really awful bass line. Do 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 do. And then Tom came in and did like that wah pedal guitar, and then it was me singing. It was like, the fucking transplants, yeah, they're coming on stage now, the fucking transplants, you better watch your fucking back. So that was how I was learning Pro Tools, trying to write an intro song for the transplants as a joke. Okay, so story behind I Miss You. So Tom brought in the original idea for the song, and the verses were the same, but when it got to the chorus, it kind of instead of picking up the pace, it kind of went, I miss you, oh, I miss you, oh, like that. And it just felt like there wasn't a proper chorus. And so I came up with this bass line, and Tom was trying to write a guitar part over the bass line, but he was following me. So what happened is the bass does the walk up, and then the guitar walks up. And I wrote, "Don't waste your time on me, you're already the voice inside my head." And so what you just saw was that moment where we lost the old chorus and wrote the new chorus.
Clear vision of where we wanted to take our music. The songs are a lot more diverse, and there's a lot more emotion in the songs.
So far.
Oh my God. So 60 days in, we have two songs in. Two songs in the can. 60 days in.
I mean, you know, two great songs. Now all we gotta do is record a bunch of and throw together the rest of the album. Coming up next on Album Launch, the people that we are renting the house from, they want their house back. There's no way we're gonna move out of here. They're just gonna have to kick us out.
Oh. I remember that.
Time to go record the Blink record. The perfect world.
Stockholm syndrome.
The record in 3 months, maybe 4 months. But this time we're building each song individually. You know, doing drums, guitar, bass, singing, adding more things, and then starting on the next song, and maybe going back to the first song later.
What the hell look am I rocking back then? What possessed me to wake up in the morning knowing full well that I was going to go in and do an interview on tape for MTV and go, this is the one. This is the look I want to do, I want to run with for my MTV interview today. Also, if you see Groundskeeper Willie in the corner over there on the left-hand side of your screen, that bass was sold for charity just recently.
On and trying all this different stuff out, so who knows? It might take 5 years.
Oh, I love that song. Whoa.
18 is your old reason. The pictures, they do what I wish they would do.
Old lyrics.
If you're playing it, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1.
Now, Travis is about to leave on tour of the transplants, so he works with us from noon to 6 every day. And he goes to transplants rehearsal.
See, me going on the transplants tour is going to put things behind a little bit. Well, hopefully we'll be done with all our songwriting.
Look at those baby blues. There's nothing
I can do about it, you know? Going on tour, there's nothing I can do. What I plan on doing is, like, getting a bunch of drum beats, a bunch of, you know, parts, and then giving them, like, a big box of my creativity before I leave on that tour.
gonna be fun.
So sleepy. I'm very sleepy. My kid gets up at 4:30 in the morning.
True.
I'm here at the studio till midnight. So I have to catch up on my sleep while Travis does his drum stuff.
By the way, do you see all the snares? If I push left arrow, am I going to go back to the beginning? No, I'm not. Good. Look at all those snares in the back.
I think I laid down some winners. That was very creative.
I'm going to miss you, Travis. I miss you, too. I really should call me a message for us, and then we'll play.
Hey, there's... Is that my GameCube in the back on the shelf there? I think that's my GameCube back there.
Your phone. What's up, you guys? It's Travis. I'm in Detroit tonight. Just I miss you guys. I hope you guys are making a kick-ass record. Things like that. Help me out.
You can tell Travis is just barely tolerating me there.
It's so slow. We worked for 10 hours yesterday. And all we did was try different guitar sounds, different guitar cabinets.
By the way, speaking of, sorry to keep pausing, but see that bass six right there? He still lives with me. Same bass. Still here. Bass was made in 1960. It is 60 years old as of this year, and it lives at my house.
Yesterday, and all we did was try different guitar sounds, different guitar cabinets with different heads, different guitars with different strings, different this with different that, different microphone placements, different everything. We've been here for like 3 hours, and we haven't actually started recording guitars yet. It's a lot of work to get the guitar sounds right.
Guitar sounds awesome. This guitar sounds awesome.
1, 2, 3, 4. 2, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah, the people that we are renting the house from, they want their house back. I don't think that we're going to be done in time for them to come back and take their house. There's no way we're going to move out of here. They're just going to have to kick us out.
Today, they did kick us out.
New studio.
But we will be moving on to greener pastures. We will go to another studio. We will write awesome songs.
Stockholm Syndrome.
Tom's about to record a lick unlike any other lick that's ever been recorded. Show him how it's going to go, Tom. For real. Show him the real part that you're about to record.
This is my lick.
Show him the guitar part you're about to record.
Stockholm Syndrome.
This guitar does not sound good ever since it broke and got written all over it.
Yeah. That thing's going to hurt you.
This crack is just going to keep getting bigger.
Oh, I miss Jerry so much.
One of these days it's going to spring off and break your other hand.
No!
Yes.
It will. It'll be a big shocker if you're playing. No. 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 No! Would it really break my hand?
Yes.
All right, well, I guess I'll have to break this guitar. Let's go outside and break it.
Yes!
You can break the drum, you're so cool!
Then he ran over with his car. Oh, there you go. He ran over with his car.
Nice to see you.
Good to see you. When Travis took off, we had so much work to do. We had like 6 songs we were kind of working on at that period of time. When we came back, we still had 5.5 left to go. So it's like, it didn't even matter.
Oh, Scandalous.
We're taking photos for our record.
Yeah, so Esteban Oriol did all of the photos, artwork. He and Mr. Cartoon put together all the artwork, the Soul Assassins crew, for the Untitled record. So this is a video shoot in San Diego where Scandalous took us all around and we did the photo shoot for the album.
The only thing that's ruining the photos is
Jeez.
This is stressful, Daddy. A million people calling us for a million different things.
You.
We gotta play shows today. Not today, we gotta play shows coming soon. We haven't played in like a year.
A rehearsal day at Conway Studios. So, that's an expensive rehearsal day. Conway Studios is one of the nicest studios in L.A., one of the most expensive recording studios in L.A. We had the big room, and we were using it to rehearse for tour. That's an expensive rehearsal. Probably should have thought that one through.
I think we're supposed to play a show in like 10 days or something. We'll probably be really good because we haven't played in a year.
We were asked to do some shows a long time ago. We said, hey, yeah, let's book those shows because it's going to be so far in the future. We'll be done with our record. It'd be no big deal. Well, what happened was is the record was taking way longer than we thought.
What's today? Tuesday?
Yeah.
We have two more days here. We have to do all Roger's stuff and all the rest of Travis's drums.
Okay. Just so you know, Roger is Roger Joseph Manning Jr., who comes in and does all the synth stuff on Blink's albums up through, I think he might have come for Untitled, actually. Not Untitled, I meant Neighborhoods. But yeah, Roger Joseph Manning Jr. came in. Hey, look, there's my microphone. That is my blue bottle microphone. That was the one. That was the one that I bought, and then the kind people at Blue actually took the blue sleeve of that and powder-coated it hot pink for me. That's the mic.
And there's no way that we're going to get all that done in 2 days.
We're trying to finish up the record. We have these shows booked. And to have a record out by a certain point, we need to finish it by a certain point.
Well, we got the Cure song, and Travis wants to do two more songs from scratch.
Yeah, I'm right. I don't see that happening. Are you serious?
See where all these like red lines are?
So, it's me, Ryan Hewitt, Jerry Finn, and Tom. Ryan Hewitt was the engineer for the album.
We're gone. That's when we're gone. So we're right here now. So, obviously, we're up here. Then we go to Pittsburgh for those 2 days. We come back.
Also, if you look at the progress board behind us, Tate's behind Jerry's head. That's our progress board. So, it looks like there are drums, probably, and maybe bass and guitar on. And that's it for most of those songs.
We leave for Japan on that day.
We have four more songs to do.
I know. Is that gonna be, are we going to be able to do that?
It's really down to you guys finishing with lyrics so we can do vocals.
Which you two seem to be dragging your feet on.
So, I think if we don't do the three songs, we just do the Cure song, and then we do all the other overdubs and singing.
Right.
There's a chance we could get it
there. That's a chance.
Yeah.
After the break, does Blink-182 have enough time in Los Angeles? I said a good that time. Yeah.
Up ahead on album launch.
We need to finish this album. That's what it comes down to.
Jesus, we get it.
We had missile warnings in aircraft today that we were flying to Kuwait, you know? I didn't know if I was always going to come home.
I didn't realize it had our trip to the Middle East on here.
Welcome to the Blink Record. We're here live in the studio.
Hey! That's my Roland synth bass. That somebody was asking me on Discord or on Twitch or somewhere about the basses used in Always, and I went out with Jerry Finn to this place called, what was it called? Black Market Music. It was on La Cienega. It was this place where you could buy old gear, and we went there just looking for music gear, and I found that bass to play on Always, because it was like a bass that you plug into this giant pedal board that puts out these synth sounds. And so that's the bass.
We had, a bunch of work to do still. We had these shows. And so we didn't know if we were going to have, like, if the show was going to have to get canceled or if we were going to have to postpone the album or what.
Baller. Look at us showing up in limos, getting on a private jet. So yeah, when Canada was having SARS, we actually went up and played a show in Sarnia Festival in Sarnia.
After, you know, 6-7 months in the studio.
So we went to play the show in Sarnia, and it's kind of out in the middle of nowhere. And we played the festival, which you just saw. And then afterwards, we all ran and hopped in this van that was driven by a local crew guy, a runner. And so there's the venue, and there's one hotel that's right there. So we ran, we got in the car, got in the van, and he takes off back behind the stage, and he's bringing us around to the hotel. But kids are already running to the hotel because they're not dumb. There's only one hotel for all the bands to stay in. So they're trying to go over there. And as we pull in behind, so the guy goes, oh, I'll take you to the back entrance. And he pulls in behind, and he pulls up, trying to drop us off right at the door, but there's all these parked cars, and he pulls the van up alongside and starts scraping against another car that's parked there, and it lasted like 5 or 6 seconds, just... And then we're like, all right, cool, and we hopped out and went to the hotel.
Enabled us to kind of be a band again and go over there and play shows. And
also, sorry to keep pausing, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, that's the first show that our tour manager, and now my manager, Gus Brandt, took over for, so... We were playing at Heinz Field. I think we played after some big heavy metal band that night. But that was my first introduction to Gus Brandt.
Why we were doing this.
This is the brand new song that we're playing tonight for the first time in front of anybody, so I hope you don't f*** it up.
By the way, during this set, I'm super, super nervous because the guys from Cheap Trick are on the side of the stage watching our band play. They came up and were like, oh yeah, our kids are huge fans of your band. We listen to your music all the time at our house. We're going to watch you play as we walk on stage. I'm like, oh great, great. Cheap Trick is going to watch me play new songs that I haven't practiced and I have no idea how to play.
Good to go out and play live shows. We've been in the studio for 7 months, and to be able to go out and play as a band just felt really good. Felt like refreshing.
Reading and Leeds.
Those are probably the best shows of our life. I think we were really, I don't know, we were on top of our game.
So gnarly.
It was such a scary trip in the Middle East. I thought I was going to die the whole entire time. When you get launched off a carrier, and the carrier's moving, so the plane can have more speed, but if the plane doesn't get off the carrier runs you over. I mean, when you have experiences like that for 5 days straight, it's almost like it was a bad dream. It didn't even happen. And when I say bad dream, it was the most amazing experience.
We had missile warnings in aircraft today that we were flying to Kuwait, you know? I didn't know if I was always going to come home. It sounds weird, you know? I'm sure our soldiers think that every day, meeting and playing for the...
So, yeah, we flew to the Middle East. We went to Bahrain, stayed the night there. The next day we got up and we visited a Navy base where we went and visited the families and the troops there. And we got to climb around a nuclear submarine that was a dock. And then you saw me there on the periscope, and I actually climbed into one of the torpedo tubes, and that was a photo. And then while we were in there, Esteban was like, hey, stand underneath this light. And he took a picture of us, and that became a poster of us huddled around this one lamp. And then that night we played a show for the sailors stationed at that base. And then the next day we took a helicopter. No, not a helicopter. We got in a C-130 air transport and were flying to Kuwait City Airport to go visit the Marines and the troops who were on the Kuwaiti side of the Iraqi border. And as we were landing in the C-130, all these alarms started going off, and the pilot immediately took evasive action, pushing forward the stick, and the whole crew went into total action mode, and we're like, I don't see it. What do you do? I fire on the thing? Oh. They're communicating back and forth with one another. Meanwhile, the plane's going, and we're just looking at each other like, what the fuck is happening? And eventually, like after what felt like 15 minutes, but was probably 30 seconds, they were like, okay, we're clear. We're clear. Clear on my side. Clear on my side. And they pulled it back up and went about their business. And we were like, what the hell just happened? And they said, oh, you know, sometimes they lock missiles on us. They laser sight us just to fuck with us. Last week they fired on us, but, you know, we fired our flares and nothing happened. But sometimes they just do it to fuck with us. Eh. Like it was a normal thing for them. And it was so gnarly to think that that's their reality every single day, flying in and out of Kuwait City Airport. So we went to Kuwait. Got in these Toyota 4Runners that just flew through the desert out to this base along the front lines, met the Marines there, flew back to Bahrain that night, and then the next morning we got up, got in a helicopter, flew out to the Nimitz, which is an aircraft carrier in the middle of the Persian Gulf, played a show for the sailors on the ship, and then the next day they launched us off on a COD. So we got launched off the aircraft carrier, and then we flew to Crete, where we were stuck for a while because it was so hot that the plane couldn't take off. And part of us were able to take off and go to London the next day. Our crew ended up on this really strange journey where they had to take like 5 different flights and go to all these different countries before they got home. Pretty gnarly. Pretty heavy trip. Really makes you appreciate what our troops go through every single day. Whoops.
Troops that are in the armed forces was the most enlightening and humbling experience I've ever had.
There's that. There's the torpedo tube. To this day, I still have people come up to me and they'll say, hey, I was on that aircraft carrier, or hey, I was one of the Marines in the field, or hey, you played at my naval base, and it's a huge honor.
Pressure's definitely on, you know? We need to finish this album. That's what it comes down to. We need to finish this record. And we haven't been doing it lately. But Jerry wanted to do... Hey, what's the 80s song called?
So where are we here? Let's see how much we have done at this point. I Miss You, Down, Obvious, Here's Your Letter, and Violence.
Hey, what's the 80s song called? Always? So basically,
here's Rick, our old manager.
Quite frequently over the last month, and there's so much stuff going on, and it's really tricky to schedule all this stuff around.
Well, I got a question. Are those dates locked in?
So that's Darren Wolf. He was our inside man at the label. He was the guy. He was a friend of mine. He was at my wedding. He was a big advocate for Blink from day one. He was our guy at the label who we could call and get the real deal from. He was always straight with us. He's a good person. And the other guy is named Chris Georgian. I made him up. When I first met him, he was a Blink fan who worked at a movie theater, and he used to let me into the movies for free in Poway. And he said that he wanted to get involved in the music business, and I introduced him to Rick DeVoe. And he started interning for Rick DeVoe, and then he started working for Rick DeVoe, and now he's a manager on his own. I think he works with Pat Magnarella, the last time that I heard.
We're done, because here's the issue.
Yeah.
What happens when Brand Spanking New comes to us and says we want you guys on the 13th?
It doesn't include his palace date.
Oh, label meeting. Oh, check it out. Label meeting.
I don't know what that means.
this is.
I'm telling you right now.
I'm telling you right now, you got my lyric
book. This is my book. This is my book. Back off. This is why we have problems. You know, why we can't get done on time.
Do you realize the credit sheets that I've been here for the last 3 days trying to get, he just ripped up?
Come in here and rip up.
I'm sorry. Okay? I'm sorry. Shouldn't have ripped up the credit sheets. I didn't like people coming into the studio and telling us that we had to hurry up and finish the record. We were making art, okay? Don't mess with my art.
Hey, they dismantled on me, and this is what happens. Rappers don't do this.
At this point, it's really picking up. The whole machine is starting up, and we're trying to finish the record.
I don't want to have to do all the press and all the pictures, but we're going to do it. So now we're going to start doing press all over the place. But you know what? It's good, though, because we really want to tell people what we're thinking.
We'll do international press where you sit in a hotel or you sit in a studio for 8 or 9 hours.
I remember those days.
Lately, we've been having really good interviews. I think a lot of people are really interested about the new record and really excited for the change. And they've been asking good questions. In the past, the questions always revolved around, like, say, oh, Tom, you've been so handsome for so long. How does David Hasselhoff compete?
It's cool. You're telling me about what you just created.
Do you guys see me just leaping in the background behind Tom?
So long. How does David Hasselhoff compete?
It's cool. You're telling them about what you just created, you know? So I'm not mad at that. I think I love the opportunity.
We wrote, like, our hardest song, like, our most, like, aggressive.
Literally, we would sit in a... I mean, granted, it was the Four Seasons Hotel in Carlsbad at the time, but we would sit there for 8 hours a day, do interview after interview after interview, answering the same questions. It's brutal. What we have to go through as musicians, you have no idea.
So,
talking about ourselves?
This record, we probably wrote our slowest, like, darkest song on this record.
Okay, your fresh interview is ready whenever you are.
I'm ready, right
okay.
Now.
Okay.
There she is.
What is the best item you've ever splurged on?
Best?
Lips.
Oh my god. What is the best item you've ever splurged on? And Tom says, lips. Oh my god.
After 2 days of press, Tom has reached his breaking point right now. He's talking about erections. That band over there, I'm not in. I'm in this band. Hi.
Easy Target? Yeah, okay. Interesting point about Easy Target. Travis wanted to record, normally you record the drum set in its entirety, in one take. Travis wanted to record every single part of the drum kit separate from each other so that rather than the room condenser mics sucking everything in and kind of gluing everything together, there's a separation between the different elements. You can put different effects on different things and make it sound special and different and a little bit weird. It sounds a little foreign to the ear. So he would like record that ribbon crasher. He would record a snare. He'd record other stuff all separately on separate tracks so that it sounded weird. See, there's the snare. It's what you wanted. I don't know whose face that is, taped to the baffle behind me. Anybody recognize that?
That's rad. That sounds really cool.
Boomer? Was that Boomer?
Sounds really cool. I like it a lot.
Here's your letter.
Really kind of is the last day in the studio. Oh yeah, a little nervous maybe. Maybe a little nervous to know that we have to send our little boys off to school to say, hey, hope we raised you right.
hope that you're a good little person. Hope you can deal with all the problems that are out there in the world. That's what it's like sending your songs off.
I'll be so happy to have the record finished and be coming out, but at the same time, we have to come up with the enhanced CD-ROM, finish the artwork, pick the single, and shoot the video, and that's all in the next 2 weeks.
It's a pain in the ass. Like, you know what I mean?
Hey, look at our progress board behind us.
The finished package, like, we're going to be so stoked.
People, I work really, really hard for you. You're gonna love it. You guys are doing great. Just keep listening.
Coming up on album launch, we've all been
enhanced CD-ROM. That was a big deal for a while. Enhanced CD-ROM. Stop people from burning the record, burning the CD, and downloading off the damn Napster. Give them the extra content. Make it worth their money to go out and buy a CD. Have the CD-ROM. You can put it in your computer. It's a CD, a music CD. But if you put it in your computer, you can watch videos on it. Got him!
Whatever does is really sexy and really horny.
I'm gonna have a baby tomorrow and I'll talk to you guys in 2 days. Say hello, everybody.
Ah, Landon.
So my name is Landon.
This is Esteban again.
Here today with Scandalous shooting the videos for the enhanced CD. Scandalous is a photographer and he does videos, and Travis brought him in.
I just started like throwing at him, you know, one after the other, like, do this, take photos for this, do our CD cover, do our CD enhancement.
With the enhanced CD, it's like 20 something minutes of video footage put to the music.
We looked at our whole record as a giant art project. I mean, we wanted there to be imagery, like artistic imagery, to go along with the music.
So in Violence, a story about the writing of Violence, when it gets to the end of the choruses, it goes into like a 4 count of white noise. And what happened there was I was playing it and I was tracking it, and I got to that point in the song and I forgot what the next note was, and in frustration it just went, ah, and I hit all the strings and made this, and it sounded really cool. And we were like, well, why don't we incorporate that into the song itself? And then we were like, well, why don't we get rid of that and we'll put white noise in at that point. So that's why the white noise is in the end of the choruses of Violence. So what we did for those was we went to Travis's warehouse in the Inland Empire, and Esteban met us out there, and we filmed a bunch of stuff in Travis's warehouse around different backdrops. But it was a warehouse, and it was the middle of summer, and it was so hot. We're just sweating like crazy the whole time.
There's a couple things that happened in our band. I mean, when we first had our first amount of success, things kind of spun out of control, and we didn't have control of anything, and people would run with stuff. We would show up places and see how we're portrayed, and it wasn't the way we wanted to be, you know, but we didn't have control over it.
I think that on this record, we really wanted to keep everything very close to us, because this record is so personal to all three of us, that we really wanted to be involved with every single aspect of it, from the enhanced CD stuff, to the songs, to the photographs that we have. Everything about our band now, I just feel, is really legitimately us. I love the look of this picture. I think you look cool in it.
It's cool, and it's our band, and it represents what we're about, and how we want to portrayed to everybody, you know?
It's a total big deal because it's the back of our record that's going to be there for the rest of your life.
I think no matter what photo you showed me for the back of the record, that was a big photo, I'll be sitting here like this with it.
America, is this picture good for good? Is that the one?
That's the one. That's the one. That's the back of the album.
We're going up to the rooftop to shoot the video film this.
Shot the video in an abandoned prison. So creepy.
So
our first setup of the day.
When we first started talking about the video, David LaChapelle was our first choice. He was someone that, as an artist, has this incredible vision for things.
We wanted the video to be a little mini art project as well. We wanted it to look different. We wanted it to feel different. Everything he ever does is really sexy and really,
it's going crazy. They're naked, like half naked. They have like tattoo symbols on them. It's pretty amazing.
As far as like a first introduction to this, I think that Feeling This is the song that kind of shows the direction that we're going in now.
But it's like, we need a good
what a rad video
to show the kids what this record's all about.
This time, smile fades in the summer.
I love that video.
We are in Los Angeles listening to mixes.
There's songs getting mixed around the country.
Mark and Tomer in San Diego listening to mixes.
And the way that we've been getting it is through an ISDN line.
What's it called, Alan? It
comes out of their board, and everyone can hear it in the studios. Studios in Los Angeles, studio in San Diego.
There you go. And that's what we're doing right now.
The wonders of the internet.
So, speaking of... want to know how to spend $1 million making a record? This is how you do it. You have a studio that you've rented in Miami, Florida, where Tom Lord Alge is mixing songs. You rent a studio in Los Angeles, Chalice, one of the nicest studios in LA, for Travis to go to. And you rent a studio in San Diego for me and Tom to go to. So you're paying for three studios to mix one song. And we did this for days and days and days because the album was due... and normally what they do back then was they would do a mix, they would FedEx a CD overnight to you, you would listen to it, you would send back your mix notes, they would go back the next day and they would take your mix notes and go and bring back up the board and do all the changes that you wanted and send you another CD. So instead of doing that, what we were doing was we were using an ISDN line where literally Tom Lord Alge would sit in his studio in Miami and we would listen to it both in LA and San Diego.
You know, it's not just for pornography. You can actually do productive stuff on it. Hi, how are you?
This technology was so new back then. We were so like, wow, we can actually listen to music over the internet? That's crazy.
Hi. Who's over there today?
Here in San Diego is Mark and Tom.
Dynamic duo.
Do we have another connection today or is it just us?
Yeah, we should have another connection with Chalice in L.A.
Okay.
Yeah, we're right here.
Can we hear back one more time, just real quick? Sorry.
The end bit, yeah. Yeah.
I think the song sounds fantastic, by the way, but I just want to hear more attack from the drums. You know what I mean?
Okay.
That'd be badass for me.
I think the morning on the 8th, October 8th, we were still like listening to mixes.
Easy Target, we recorded the drums really weird. I don't know if you looked at it yet. It's supposed to sound really industrial. There's like a ribbon crasher. I don't know. I'm sure I'll hear it the following day.
Okay.
So I'm gonna have a maybe tomorrow and I'll talk to you guys in 2 days.
The 9th came around. I kind of left my house that morning at like 5 a.m. I had a baby at like 8:19 a.m.
This is my son, Landon, that's my girlfriend. Today's the 10th, and it feels like I had him a year ago already.
It's crazy. Landon's like a full-on adult now, almost.
I'm still a kid, you know? She's still a kid, too. That's what's crazy.
That's going to be one of the first things he wears when he's
I feel way different now that I'm a dad. The minute you have that baby, like, I don't know. I was so careless. I didn't care about anything. And now I drive better, and I don't know. I think about everything like 100 times before I do it, you know?
Say hello, everybody. Say my name is Landon. Landon.
Day 295. Oh my god.
Whenever
record gets mixed, it's the final phase of the recording procedure, and we had literally hours to turn this thing in to have it come out on time, and it was crazy stressful. It was not rad to have that happen after you spend a very long time making a record where time wasn't part of a factor. I mean, we took our time, and when it came down to the last stretch, it just ended up to be the polar opposite of that, and it was just like, run for your life and get this record to the to the factory.
I don't think that there's time to even mix another song tomorrow.
It's gotta be done today. There's no way they're
gonna get it. Tomorrow's Thursday. We have to, the thing has to be totally done tomorrow to ship to the plant on Friday. The original due date got pushed back, and then it got pushed back and got pushed back again, to the point where it came down to Jordan, the president of the label, making calls and saying, what is the absolute last possible second that we can turn this thing in and still make our release date? I mean, we turned it in at the very, very deadline. Even past the deadline. It's the last mix of the record, and I think tonight our work will be done, and it will be in the hands of people that are smarter and more talented than us.
The demo for the record got turned in. I think we listened to a final mix from somebody else, I'm feeling this, besides Jerry Fenn's, and then we ended up picking Jerry Fenn's, and I think that was the official, like, finish of the record, like the wrap.
The question is, are we done? We don't know if we're done. Mark, are we done?
It's never done. That's the answer.
More expensive studio time. That's Capitol Records in the background. We were in the Capitol Records studio in the basement downstairs listening to mixes from Tom Bodalgi in Miami.
Never done. It's an ongoing process.
You know what half the record is us performing it. When we're done performing it, then it'll be done, like, completely. Stop asking so many questions.
Is it done? It's only started.
Coming up next on Album Watch.
We're gonna buy a record. You gotta do it, you gotta support yourself.
I'm John Norris with an MTV News Brief, where you might want to call him Buck 182, because come November, $1 is all it will cost to catch Blink 182 on a rare club tour.
That's right.
We are gearing up to trek across the United States and do a bunch of shows that cost a dollar.
Buck 182. Price to put on our shows. Dollar Bill Tour.
We didn't really want anyone to sponsor the tour, so we decided to pay for it ourselves.
Wow! For the Dollar Bill Tour.
We did spend a lot of days for rehearsal for this tour, too.
You guys having a good time tonight?
Two big, long, crazy days.
Yeah!
And actually, the first day was cut short because we figured that we'd get back to it the second day. But we'll be, you know, I think the tour is like 2 weeks long, and we'll be like kick-ass by the end of week two.
We are in Boston, did our first show in the Dollar Bill Tour. We have like literally 2 weeks and our record comes out, and we're playing like half of the songs on the record live every night. So obviously it's getting closer to the day our record comes out, so everything's more exciting.
I'm excited about tonight. I'm very excited to go out and play these new songs, but you never know until you actually walk out on stage if you're gonna up or if you're gonna be all right or what's gonna happen.
I think that we forgot our teleprompters though, so let's hope that I don't forget the lyrics.
What'll happen if you do?
I'm just up. I just wanna call it art.
Hello, Boston! This tonight here is the very, very first time we ever played this song live. Hey, if we f up tonight, I'll give you your dollar back. The song's gonna get you.
So witty.
Shows are going to be different than those shows we just played over in the festivals and in Europe and stuff. The whole atmosphere is different. We're not going to have any explosions and flaming signs and things of that nature. Now you're just going to have to hear the music.
Remember shows? Remember when we used to go to shows and people would like be just packed into a room, having a good time, seeing each other, singing along, sweating on each other. Remember shows? I like those. Let's do those again.
I liked that show. It was a lot of fun. It was a little rough.
velocity in some parts, let's say B minus, C plus kind of show?
I think we can be a lot better. We will be.
I think this episode was rough.
Somebody had some drinks during the show.
I think we can be a lot better. We will be.
I think this set was rad. I just think we have to move quickly.
Yeah.
Because if you grab them by the balls and then we kind of like, we grab them and then we let them down and then we grab them. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Keep them.
Totally.
Two more shows. It'll be golden.
Hey, we're in New York at Irving Plaza on the Dollar Bill Tour.
Gus Brandt. That's Gus Brandt back there.
We are both with our friends and getting ready for the show.
First time we ever played in New York was at this venue. We played with an old punk rock band called Fear.
It's true.
And that's what we felt the whole entire time. There's skinheads out in the audience that didn't like songs about dicks. But we are here. Different songs this time.
We're going? Let's do this, huh?
No. I'm gonna stay here. It's you and me now. You're not invited. I gotta go.
It was amazing, man. I love the pressure of New York shows because it makes you play better.
Yeah, that was really good. Really, that was so good.
That's Daryl Eaton. He's our longtime friend and agent. He's the one that put together the Warped Tour for all of the tours. He was at my wedding as well.
Oh my God, where did that come from?
That was our end of recording party right there. That was it. That was the one.
It's just what we do.
So today we're at New York MTV, and we are about to perform live on the rooftop of MTV.
We did.
Driving in a 59 Cadillac convertible, which is amazing. I've never even driven a car in New York before. Kids crawling at you, it's funny. It's cool though.
Can I get this for free? This is the exact same size of a top of a chair that I usually sit on at home. The chair's like this. You sit on there and it gives you the ability to spin around in several directions as you might be on the internet, watching TV, cooking, whatever, what have you, what have I not? I don't know.
Look at all the people that liked me before I was a famous Twitch streamer.
Yeah, it was fun, man. It was a good time. I think you played good too. We usually get really freaked out when we're playing TV, but I think it was like good energy with those kids up there, you know?
I think it was awesome. I think, well, you see, our dollar shows, I think we pretty much played worth a dollar. This one was free. I think it was pretty much worth free. We are on our way to put out a record. I don't know, 18. I'm not sure really when. 8th Tuesday, or I don't know. Why don't we go back to LA? What are you asking? Who are you? I'm just kidding.
I don't really have any apprehensions about the CD
Those CDs, before the internet, you had to actually have a physical copy of media that you wanted to play. First it was wax cylinders, later on it was tape. And then late 80s and 90s, CDs were a thing. Look it up.
I'm anxious for it to come out. I'm excited for people to hear the new songs.
I'm not in fear of what anyone's going to think. I think everyone's going to love it. And I don't know. I have no fears.
It's such a long project, you know? And
The only anticipation I have is when you bring it up and make me nervous. I don't know what's going to happen when the record comes out. I'm not thinking about it. But when this guy over here asks me, it makes me nervous.
It is 11:15 on the 17th of November, and our record comes out in nearly an hour.
321 days.
We are K-Rock, Los Angeles. Morning show, Kevin Bean. Millions and millions of listeners. We will be debuting our record on the day it comes out, which is today. It just so happens to be today.
Now's a test. Everyone has a record. Let's see what they say. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I want to go buy a copy.
Right? How weird is it? This is my first time seeing my old lady keeps passing by and saying...
Yeah, that was the House of Blues. House of Blues is gone now. And it was so rad to drive down Sunset Boulevard and see our billboard promoting our new album.
So rad. We're going to go buy our record. You got to do it. You got to support yourself.
In the beginning, like, I think all our goals, I think we accomplished them all. I really feel like proud of it. It feels good. It feels like when you just have your baby, you know, sort of when your baby, like, that's what a new record feels like.
Pushing each other into these new directions, I think, has been really an education. So I don't know where the next record will take us, but I'm excited to find out. That's a good ending. You should have held for the beat, though.
There's only one place we can go, and I think that's all the way. I mean, I think we're going to start distributing our music throughout space.
They say life that's is it. All about making choice.
That was it. Wait, how come it's not going? My Stream Deck guy is not working. Oh, because I'm in Safari. That's why. Let's go camera feed. So that was it. I had not watched... Maybe I watched that before. I don't remember it, though, if I did. But that brought back a lot of rad memories. Good times. So, I guess... Let's see. I've been streaming for an hour. Let's take some questions. Let's take some calls. Actually, we'll call Gus right now. Oh, Travis texted me. Best tattoos on Instagram. Call Gus Brandt.
Calling Gus Brandt, iPhone.
Good afternoon.
Hi, Gus Brandt. You're on the stream. You're on the Twitch.
Oh, nice. Hi, Mark. How are you?
Good. How are you today?
Excellent. Just rocking.
Did you watch any of that?
Yeah, I watched a little bit of it. It was kind of like a high school yearbook, and I just remember that house. Oh, my God.
Oh, the house we recorded in?
Yeah, before you got kicked out of every studio in the world.
Yeah, we did get kicked out of every studio. We got kicked out of Conway. We got kicked out of Rolling Thunder. We got kicked out of Signature Sound. We got kicked out of the house. I don't remember where else we were, but yeah.
I remember the Dollar Bill tour too. That was the second to last time everybody was on the same bus. Actually,
we were all on the same bus on that tour.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure because it was you paid for the tour.
Oh right, yes. When we have to pay for it ourselves.
But people got their money's worth.
That's true. I remember those shows though. Those were a lot of fun.
Those were great. Yeah. Yeah, it was cool. It was really cool. Seems like you guys did a thing. Like I said, that was when I started liking you as a band.
You know? All right.
It's a
well,
piece of art, so.
It's good memories.
Right on. Thanks for that. I hope everybody enjoyed it as much as you did and I did.
Your hair was so long back then, by the way.
I know, man. It's before the weight of the world crushed my spirit.
All right. We love you.
All right, man. You love you too.
Later.
Get back to it, man.
Bye.
Come on.
Call Tom. I will talk to Tom, but not for your amusement right now. Are there any other questions that you have? Too fast. Stream is moving too fast. All right. Thank you to everybody who listened to the record, who bought the record, who supported us. Thank you to the people in Discord for pointing out that there was a documentary. And that was fun. Let's do more of these. I will talk to you. Oh, by the way, I haven't gotten a chance to shout everybody out who's subscribed, so let's go back and do this one. Thank you, Pigeon. Thank you, Hayden. Thank you, Noah. Thank you, Tiger. Thank you, Sherman, for donating. Thank you, David, and Radioactive, and JH2, and Shelbino, and Bebout182, and who else here? Spalding. Did I say Spalding? Thank you to everybody who donated, who subscribed. All the money goes to Children's Hospital, Los Angeles. And thank you all. I will see you on the Discord.